So let's dive right in. One of the most obvious tricks that people do when trying to tell you a misleading story with data graphics is to truncate the dependent variable axis, the y-axis. So is that misleading? So this graph, you look at this graph, and you say, well, 50-50, maybe sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't, except for the fact that this axis has been truncated. This is 98 right here. That's 99. There's 100. So what this graph is actually saying is that 99% of the time, it is misleading to truncate the y-axis. Here's a graph that illustrates its own point very convincingly. Looking at it, you think, I'm saying that half the time it's OK. Not at all, right? So this is a very, very common sin in data graphic presentation. Here's an example from Maclean's, the Canadian news magazine. And they're talking about the trust problem that people have in Quebec. And they're saying, wow, you know, in the rest of Canada, people are really trusting. They trust people from work at school and from people in the neighborhood and people in general. But the Quebecois don't have this kind of level of trust. Look how untrusting they are. Really, really, look at these great big red bars for the rest of Canada and these little blue bars for Quebec. And it looks really bad for Quebec. Wow, how did something get like that? And then you notice that they've truncated the axis at 35 here. And so these bars would continue way down below the floor if we were to represent these graphics honestly. So why do they have a trust problem? Well, maybe it has something to do with their media. In their defense, somewhat, they were actually forced to retract and publish a correction to this graph. Here is this graph now done properly, going all the way down to zero. And while we do see that, yes, trust levels are lower in Quebec. Admittedly, we don't have sample sizes, we don't have error bars, those kinds of things would be nice. But you know, the trust levels are lower in Quebec, but we don't see anything like this sort of catastrophic difference and catastrophic problem that's illustrated by the original graph. Here's another graph. This graph also cuts off at 10, but this one's fine. I don't mind this one at all. So why is that? That's because this is a line graph. It's really doing something different than a bar graph is doing. A bar graph is trying to represent magnitudes of numbers. A line graph, especially a time course, is representing changes in values over time. And so what this is doing is it's zooming in on the range where these changes are taking place. This is a perfectly honest graph, in my opinion, of how changes happen over time. And in fact, if you include the x-axis, if you include zero on the y-axis, you can get into trouble. You can create accidentally or deliberately misleading graphs. Here's a notorious one that came from the Powerline blog. This was picked up and tweeted by the National Review. And it's entitled, "The Only Global Warming Chart You Need From Now On." And you know, if we step back and look at this, you can see, well, I don't know, it looks flat to me. And right, you know, global warming, look at that. Anybody see the uptick? So what's happened, of course, is they've included zero Fahrenheit in this diagram. And therefore, that has swamped out all of the subtle variations. If we zoom in, as Philip Bump did in the Washington Post, we can see a much more accurate picture of what's happening. We see, you know, starting in around the 1970s, we get this, you know, we've got a fair bit of variation year to year, but we get this consistent and extremely troubling rise that takes place after the 1970s. So this is, you know, a much more honest way, I think, to represent those data. Bloomberg News thinks so too. And they put together this graph. And sort of my interpretation is that Parmenides was right. Parmenides was a pre-Socratic philosopher who thought that time was an illusion. It doesn't actually pass. This graph proves it. Down here, we've got the year from 1900 to 2040. Here, we've got the year from 0 to 4000. Looks pretty flat to me. So the point is, you can make anything look like nothing is happening if you have the freedom to include 0 capriciously in your graphs. You can do other nefarious things if you have two different axes. So here's an example from a scientific paper, Issues in Law and Medicine. And what this paper purports to do is to show a relationship between the prevalence of autism and the level of coverage in a population by the measles, mumps, rubella vaccine, the MMR vaccine. And at first glance, like just looking at that, it looks kind of bad, you know. So autism's here in blue, MMR is in red. MMR rates fall, autism rates fall too. MMR rates come back up, autism rates go back up. You know, setting aside all of our concerns in the causation and correlation lecture, if we didn't know about that, that might look kind of troublesome. Until you notice that these axes are completely different. This one goes from 0 to 0.6%. This one starts at 86% and goes up to 95%. So these fluctuations in MMR coverage are very minor. Here's a more reasonable graph. Again, with two different axes, fine, the numbers are in different scales. But in this case, you know, we're including zero on both sides. And what we see is that there are very small fluctuations in MMR coverage and many-fold changes in autism prevalence over this period, if anything, indicating that these are unlikely to be causally connected rather than the misleading impression that you get when you do a truncation like this. So another way to kind of mislead people with axes. And I want to give you one more. Here's one more. This is about the Stand Your Ground Act. Stand Your Ground Law in Florida says, you know, you don't have to back away. You can use lethal force in defense of your person. And that was enacted in 2005. And then you see what happens to murders. Wow, Stand Your Ground looks really effective, right? Or what's wrong with this graph? Anyone see what's wrong with this graph? What's that? Yelled out. Inverted. Yeah, the axes are inverted, right? Here we've got the number of murders at 0. And the number of murders is increasing in this direction as we go down. So we're used to seeing the axis going this way. We're used to thinking, oh, that corresponds to a decline. What this is actually a massive increase in the number of murders that are created that occur after the Stand Your Ground Act is enacted. Got to be on the lookout for these things. There are a lot of misleading information. This is from Reuters. Okay, this one may have actually even been an accident, but it certainly tells a particular story if you don't take the time to look at it closely.